بالله من الشيطان اللعين الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام والتحية والكرام على النبي الأمي العربي القرشي المكي المدني الهاشمي صاحب قاب قوسين محبوب رب المشرقين والمغربين جد الحسن والحسين النبي الحامين والإمام القبلتين ورسول الثقلين الذين سمي في السماء بأحمد وفي الأرض بأبي القاسم محمد
اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد
وعلى أهل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين المعصومين المظلومين المنتخبين المنتجبين لا سيما بقية الله في العالمين وحجته على الخلائق اجمعين روحي وارواح العالمين لتراب مقتبل الفداء واللعنه الدائمه الباقيه على اعدائهم ومنكر فضائلهم وغاصب حقوقهم اجمعين اما بعد فقد قال النبي صلى الله عليه واله وسلم يا علي التوى شيعتك هم الفائزون ثم قال صلى الله عليه واله وسلم في موقف اخر علي مع القرآن والقرآن مع علي لن يفترق حتى يرد علي الحوض مساء صلوات على محمد وعلى
اللهم صل على محمد وعلى محمد
in honor of Holy Prophet of Islam say another صلوات على محمد وعلى
اللهم صل على محمد وعلى محمد
and to hasten the reappearance of our awaited Imam Hassan Al-Askari
اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد.
Continuing from yesterday, where we referred to and we spoke about the importance of the Holy Quran, we mentioned that out of the conditions for success is a relationship with those two which the Holy Prophet of Islam has entrusted the religion with, and they are the Quran and Ahlul Bayt alayhi salatu wasalam. And we mentioned a few practical considerations with regards to bringing the Quran into our lives and making it part and parcel of our schedule. And we left off yesterday saying that in order to benefit from the Holy Quran, in order to apply the Holy Quran into our lives, we require Ahlul Bayt alayhi salatu wasalam to demonstrate to us what is the real meaning and the real interpretation of this, of the Holy Book. And we mentioned some examples from the Imams alayhi salatu wasalam's lives in order to do so. To build on that, inshallah, and come to our discussion today, we are invited to do so, to refer to these personalities by the Quran itself. For example, the Holy Quran, on one occasion in Surah Ali Imran, tells us in a very long verse, tells us about the different types of verses within the Holy Quran. Tells us in Surah Ali Imran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says to us that we have revealed this Quran, and amongst them there are verses which are muhkam, which are decisive and clear. And amongst them there are mutashabihat. There are those which are allegorical, which have more than one meaning, which have different meanings. And nobody knows their interpretation, nobody knows their meaning, إِلَّا اللَّهُ وَالرَّاسِقُونَ فِي الْعِلْمِ. Apart from Allah and those who are deeply and firmly rooted in knowledge. This terminology is very interesting. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala doesn't refer to those personalities who know about the Holy Quran and who are going to tell us about the Holy Quran as ones who have a lot of knowledge. The example that I use for this is that if we have any kind of container, for example, we have a cup, and in the cup we pour some water into the cup. As long as I keep pouring water into the cup, even if it's filled to the top, I'm going to say that water is in the cup. At no point while I'm filling the water into the cup am I going to say the cup is in the water. But if I have a river or a swimming pool and I put the cup in the water, even if there's no water, doesn't go in the cup, I'm going to say that the cup is in the water. So there's a difference between water being in the cup and the cup itself being in water. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala doesn't say that these people who are going to tell you the interpretation of the Holy Quran are ones who have knowledge in them, or they are knowledgeable. He says, they are rasikhuna fil ilm. They are deeply rooted inside the knowledge. When speaking about the cup, and whenever we fill up the cup, if we continue using the same example, if the cup is 200 milliliters or 300 milliliters or 500 milliliters, then the water inside the cup will always be slightly less than the size of the cup. If it's more than it will spill over. Because the container cannot contain more than that amount. However, if the cup is in the water, then it doesn't matter how much water it is. If the cup is inside the water, you can put it into the ocean. And the ocean's water will not be affected by the size of the cup. It will still be considered to be inside the water of the ocean. Similarly, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, these are rasikhuna fil ilm. We've put them inside the knowledge. So you cannot account for how much knowledge they have, nor can you account for the fact that because they are human beings like you, that they will have limited knowledge like you have. But rather, their knowledge is not inside them, but they themselves are rooted in the knowledge, and they will tell you the interpretation of the Holy Quran. The only ones who could lay claim to such a interpretation of Rasikhuna fil ilm, even though you would go to the tafsir of the Holy Quran, you'll find some people would say Rasikhuna fil ilm refers to anybody who has knowledge of the Quran. Anybody who knows the Quran knows Rasikhuna fil ilm in some tafsir as mentioned. But if you go to the meaning of the word, then we know that there's only one person who came on the minbar of Kufa and said, Saluni, Saluni, qabla at-taqwa. Ask me whatever you want to ask. Before there comes a time where you have lost me. And only a person who really is rooted in that kind of knowledge can make such a claim. The unfortunate thing, and how this is related to our discussion about success, is the unfortunate thing is that there, in that time, were people who didn't understand in order to get success from this man, you ask him the questions of the secrets of the earth and the heavens. Instead, they asked him, how many hairs do I have on my head? Instead of asking him, in fact, there was some research regarding this particular narration from a European professor who was working on Amir al-Mu'mineen alayhi salam. And when he came to this incident and he read about it and he commented on it, he said that I teach mathematics, and if I had been in the time of Amir al-Mu'mineen where a man had made this kind of claim, then I would have asked him for solutions to all of the mathematical problems that we have. What kind of people did he have in front of him who asked him, how many heads do I have on my head?
In any case.
So this is in regards to those who can give us the interpretation, the meaning of the Holy Quran. Now, with regards to the Holy Quran itself, and as we mentioned in our, some of the examples yesterday evening about the relationship of Ahlul Bayt alayhi salam with the Quran. So we see that in every time, from the beginning of the Imamat, the Imams of Ahlul Bayt alayhi salam always placed this emphasis upon the protection and the propagation of the Holy Quran. The Holy Prophet of Islam, as soon as he passed away, the Amir al-Mu'mineen began to compile the Holy Quran, and he had made an ahad that he would not leave his house until he had compiled the Quran. When he compiled the Quran, he presented it to the government. They said that we don't accept your Quran. But Amir al-Mu'mineen had kept this Quran with the meaning and interpretation of where every single verse of the Quran had been revealed. After Amir al-Mu'mineen, of course, every Imam made this emphasis upon the Holy Quran. And it was the opposition and the people against them who would make mockery of the Holy Quran. Whether they brought the Quran onto the lances against Ibn Mu'in al-Sifin, whether it was afterwards, whether it was in the palace of the Khalifa, they would shoot arrows at the Holy Quran. All of this took place by those who claimed to be Muslims. But whenever it came to the Holy Quran, then the Imams alayhi salatu wasalam always the ones who rushed towards it, its defense. This example is mentioned from our 11th Holy Imam, very prominent story. And of course, it's important because our 11th Holy Imam is also the one who has a tafsir of the Holy Quran attributed to the tafsir of Imam Hassan al-Askari. So in his time, there's a scholar by the name of Ishaq al-Kidni, and he has compiled these contradictions in the Holy Quran. He's compiled a book which mentions particular verses of Holy Quran which contradict with another. And he has a large following. He's a big scholar. He has a large following. He has students around him. So one of his students one time comes to see Imam Hassan al-Askari. And the Imam says to him, that what is this your teacher is doing? He's writing this book about contradiction in the Holy Quran. Why didn't you say something to him? So they say, this student says, Ibn Rasulullah, we are the students, he's the teacher, what can I say to him? Anything I will say, he will be able to argue it back with me, defend his arguments. The Imam says, no, you don't need to object to anything that he's saying or doing, but rather just ask him a question. They said, Ibn Rasulullah, what question should we ask? It says, ask him the question that if a person was to write a book and there would be a dispute over the meaning of what was mentioned in that book, to whom would you refer to in order to resolve the dispute? If somebody has written a book and there's a dispute over what that book is about or what the meaning of something in the book is, to whom would you refer in order to resolve this dispute? Who would you ask in order to resolve the dispute? So the student goes towards his heart of Kindi and he asks him this question. He says, if somebody's written a book and there's a dispute over what the book means, what the meaning of certain things in the book is, who do you ask in order to resolve this query? Ishaq al-Kindi says, who told you this question? Says, who told you this question? this student says, you know, it came into my mind, I was thinking, so on and so on. Says it's not possible. Says it's not possible that this question came into your mind. He insists, you know, at first the student continues saying, no, this is my own question. Then eventually he says, no, this is not your question. You have to tell me who told you this question. So he says, yes, Imam Abu Muhammad, Imam Hassan Al-Askari, told me to ask you this question. So Ishaq al-Kindi says, yes, you are my student. If I didn't think of this question, how could you think of it? You are my student. If I didn't think of this question, how could you think of it? Surely this is a question from Ahlul Bayt alayhi salatu wasalam. Because only they could consider this. And Ishaq al-Kindi says, surely Imam Muhammad is correct. If a person has a dispute over a book that another person has written, he will go to the person who has written the book in order to clarify what the book means. In the case of the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the inheritors of the book have the right to tell us whether something is contrary in the Holy Quran or not. So then he says, he orders the fire and he says, put all these pages of the book that have been written so far, put them into the fire, and I repent from my previous beliefs regarding the contradiction of the Holy Quran. Recite Salat
al-Muhammad.
And this, the Holy Quran itself invites us to look to this. As I say, in Surah Ali Imran, it told us about Rasikhuna fil ilm, those who are the family rooted in knowledge. In Surah Al-Waqi'ah, it gives us an even greater insight into those who are the ones who can tell us about the Holy Quran. Surah Al-Waqi'ah is a very important surah. It's recommended to be recited after the Isha prayers for the increase of rizq. In this surah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks about the hereafter, what will happen on the Day of Judgment. Towards the end of the surah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says about the Holy Quran in this surah. Innahu Quranun Kareem. Surely this is a honorable Quran. This is a honorable Quran. Fi kitabim maknoon. It is an honorable Quran which is in a protected tablet. La yamassuhu illa al-mutahhar. And nobody can touch it except for those who have been purified. Now for the curious minded amongst us, you know, and this is one of the Zahiri interpretations, of course, that it is not permissible to touch the words of the Holy Quran without wudu or usul, depending on which obligation the person has upon them at the time. If a person is in a state of najasa, they cannot touch the words of the Holy Quran, and this is the apparent zahiri meaning of what this verse is talking about, that nobody can touch it except for the purified. But there's a difference between mutatahirun and mutahharun. Mutatahirun are those like you and me who purify ourselves. We do the wudu and we do the ghusl in order to purify ourselves, in order to make sure that we touch the Holy Quran with purity. But mutahharun is referring to those who have been made purified by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Those who have already been made purified by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and when the verse says nobody can touch it except for the purified ones, it means nobody can go to the reality of the Holy Quran, which is in law al-mahfuz, which is on the sacred tablet upon which it was revealed, apart from the purified ones, apart from those for whom Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed the verse, إِنَّمَا يُرِيدُ اللَّهُ لِيُذْهِبَ عَنْكُمُ الرِّجْسَ أَهْلَ الْبَيْتِ وَيُطَهِّرَكُمْ They are the ones who can go towards the meaning of the Holy Quran and tell us about is reality. And that is what they did throughout their lives of all day. Now this, we've come to the discussion about, I never thought the Imam, and I've been asked to refer to some of the other Imams whom we don't speak about so frequently. So let's mention a few more snippets from his life, and then inshallah the rest of what we want to refer to tomorrow and the day after. So Imam is, I've mentioned this is an event from his life, and what is amazing about his life is that despite the fact that he is the second youngest out of all of the Imma, he only lives for 28 years, he has a very rich and fulfilled life in terms of what happens during his life and how he guides the people. This is one example of what he showed in terms of his guidance through the Holy Quran. In other instances, the Imams always would refer to the Holy Quran in order to illuminate people. And this was the emphasis to show the relationship between Ahlul Bayt and the Quran. For example, when the Imam is very young, and there are a group of children who are playing, and the Imam was standing away from the children and he was crying. And the follower of Ahlul Bayt comes close to the Imam. He asks him, why is he crying? Maybe he thought that all the children are playing and the Imam is not playing, therefore he is sad over this. So he says, shall I bring you something? And the Imam says that, he recites a verse from the Quran. He says, we were not created in order to play. We were not created in order to play. So this companion, he thinks to himself, he says, Ya Rasulullah, you are very young, you're still a child, and this is not something that's, the implication in our lives is that the day of judgment and hereafter is things that old people are supposed to remember. When people are young, then they don't think of these things, and let alone when they are really that young. And the Imam says, no, but we have been created to obey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We have been created for His obedience. When the companion says, Allah, you're very young, and why are you fearing over hellfire? The Imam gives him a simile, an example. And this of course is not for the Imam, it's for us. The Imam says, I have observed that when my mother is lighting the oven, she puts in the small sticks of wood, the twigs, before she puts in the larger planks of wood in order to burn the fire. And this is a simile for the hellfire, where the smaller pieces will go in first before the larger ones will go. So of course the Imam Salam Alayhi does not need to worry about heaven and hellfire, we already mentioned. But it's a simile for the believers to consider that whether a person is young or old, it is the hereafter for which believers have been created. With regards to one of the points that I mentioned yesterday regarding the coming towards the Holy Quran, Imam Amir al-Mu'minin as-Salam mentions in the Sermon of Muttaqeen, which is Sermon number 192 of Nahj al-Balagha, where he characterizes and mentions the sifat of the Muttaqeen. In that, when he's talking about the Muttaqeen and the Holy Quran, he says the Muttaqeen are those who stay up all night and they recite parts of the Holy Quran. And how do they recite the Quran? He says when they recite the Quran and they get towards a verse about reward, then it's as if they are experiencing that reward themselves at that moment. And when they're reciting that verse about reward, it's as if they are experiencing the pleasure of that reward. And when it comes to a verse about punishment, they become fearful as if they were experiencing that punishment. So it's not just about reading the Holy Quran, it's about that building that relationship to feel whether I can feel the reward and I can feel the punishment even before it is come on to me. Similarly, the Imam, when he becomes, when he's now older, this particular incident is of a lot of interest because it signifies the plan of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala makes his plans regardless of how the enemy tries to plan. So it is well known that Imam is the 11th Imam, the one after him is going to be the Qa'im, and that the governments of the day know that the Qa'im is the one who is going to fill the world with justice. And we are filling the world with injustice. So we don't want the Qa'im to come because it will mean that we will be finished. So what shall we do? They all plan together, the Abbasids come and they plan together and they say that we're going to put the Imam into house arrest. So that he doesn't see anyone, he doesn't meet anyone, he doesn't go anywhere, he doesn't get married. If he doesn't get married, then he can't have children. So he's under house arrest until one day what happens? One day there's a drought in Samarra. Imam has been moved from Medina to Samarra because Samarra is the capital of the Abbasid Empire. Samarra, so called because it was a new city created by the Abbasids to make it their capital. It was called Surra Manra'a. Whoever saw it was pleased by excessive usage became Samarra. Imam is then in there under the close watch of the Khalifa. One day there's a drought in Samarra. It doesn't rain. This drought continues for a few days until the point where there's no water anywhere. And people are in a very difficult state. We've been to Iraq, know that, especially in Samarra, if you don't get water, so it becomes a very difficult situation because of the climate and the kind of atmosphere that is surrounding that region of the world. People have become very hopeless of any rain coming anytime. In all of this, a bishop shows up and he prays to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When he prays, the rain starts coming down. Some people whose iman was fluctuating say, well, maybe this is the right religion because we had a drought, there's no rain coming down, and this person has prayed and the rain has come down. The news gets to the Khalifa that this is what has happened. Khalifa says to his advisors, what shall I do? If people start to leave the religion of Islam and adopt another religion, then I will not have anybody to rule over. I am ruling over them in the name of Islam. So he says to his advisors, what shall I do? They say to him, there's only one solution. Imam Abu Muhammad, whom you have kept in house arrest, bring him out, he will be able to give you the solution. A man goes to the Imam and brings him out, and now the Khalifa is thinking about his own kingdom. He says to the Imam, Ya Ibn Rasulillah, the religion of your grandfather is in danger, you have to do something. The Imam goes there, he arrives, he sees the people have gathered around the bishop. And he says to the bishop, whatever is in your hand, give it to you. So the bishop takes out from his hand and he gives it to the Imam. Now the Imam says, now you pray for rain. So now he prays for rain and there's no effect, there's no rain. People ask, Ibn Rasulullah, what was this in his hand? Imam says this was a bone of a prophet of Allah. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made prophets mercy, and of course the manifestation of mercy is it for it to rain. And therefore, because he prayed through the bone of a prophet of Allah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent down rain. Now the Imam says, now I will pray for it. So now the Imam, without any bone, prays for rain.
people start to go towards
their homes.
The Imam says, no,
you don't need to rush towards your homes, these clouds are not for Salah.
Then another set of clouds appear. The Imam says, these clouds are not for Salah either. Then a third set of clouds appear, and the Imam says, these are the clouds for Samara, but remember that until the last person has not entered into his house, it will not start to rain. As soon as the Imam does all of this, he prays a two-rakat prayer. He prays this just as when Amirul Mu'mineen had brought them dead man back to life, he prayed the two rakat. To say, remember that all of this is from the power of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Do not think that I did this for myself, that I'm worthy of being worshipped because I did this. No, this was through the power of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then the Imam, now all these people who have gathered, they've never seen the Imam before. So they say to the Khalifa, they say everything is fine. And now we have rain as well. Who is this young man? This young man, we've never seen him before. Who is he? And you know, he did this amazing task. They ask the Imam. The Imam says, I'm the guest of the Khalifa. Now of course the Khalifa cannot say that he's put the Imam in prison, he's under house arrest, he's being watched. So, the Khalifa is embarrassed, and instead of saying all of this, he points towards the house of our 10th Holy Imam. And he says, the Imam lives here. Because he had said this, he was forced to release the Imam from the house arrest and send him to the house because people are going to come and visit him. For this reason, out of all of our Imams, if you go to the places where they are buried far away from their homes. Every one of our Imams is buried far away from their homes. Except for our 10th and 11th Holy Imams who are buried in the place in which they lived. The shrine in Samarra is in the place where our 10th and 11th Holy Imams used to live. So he releases him and sends him to this house of the 10th Holy Imam. This is for a period of a year, and it is during that year that Imam Salamu Alaihi marries Sayyid Anarjis and our 12th Holy Imam is born. Recite Salamu Alaihi Muhammad. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reminds, wa makaru wa makarallah, wallahu khairul makirin. You had tried to prevent the birth of our Qa'im by doing your methods, but we forced you to release the Imam and bring him into his own house and allowed the Qa'im to be. This is with regards to a snippet into the life of our 11th Holy Imam, who only lives for 28 years, but demonstrates through his life this importance of being adherent to the Holy Quran, this importance of realizing what the Imam is about, and of course the most greatest service of his to keep the 12th Imam protected from all the enemies. Up until he goes into Ghaybat, the 11th Holy Imam is the one who keeps our 12th Holy Imam protected and in Ghaybat from all the enemies. Only a few handful of people know about the Imam and about his existence and about his birth and about his whereabouts, and nobody else, even though the Khalifa is adamant to try and find out, they're unable to do so. Finally, one example that I want to mention from the 11th Holy Imam's life, which is mirrored from an example from the house of Amir al-Mu'minin. You'll recall in the famous story when Imam Amir al-Mu'mineen alayhi salam and Hazrat Zahra did the nadr and they fasted for 3 days when Imam Hassan and Imam Hussain alayhi salam became unwell. When they fasted, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed the verses in their honor, about how they had given away their iftar on each of the 3 days. Story is well known. What I want to mention from that story is something that is relevant to our lives at the moment and is reflected in the life of our 11th body. When the first person came towards the house of Amir al-Mu'minin alayhi salam on the first day when they were doing iftar, that person said that I am a miskeen, I'm a poor person and I don't have any food, so give me some food. And they gave their iftar to this poor person. Then the second day, the person who came and he had said that I'm an orphan and I don't have any food, so the second day they gave their food. On the third day he had said, I'm a captive, I was a prisoner of war and I've been released and I don't have any food. So they gave their food away. As far as poor people in Medina was concerned, that person was probably a Muslim. As far as an orphan is concerned, the orphan was also probably a Muslim. As far as captive is concerned, as far as a prisoner of war is concerned, in Medina there were no prisoners of war who were Muslims. Almost certainly that person was not a Muslim. But Amir al-Mu'minin alayhi salatu wasalam's generosity is such that he did not ask the person, are you Muslim or not? If the person came and said, I have a need, if I can fulfill your need, I will fulfill your need, I will not ask the question whether you are a Muslim or not. This is important. From Imam Amir al-Mu'minin. From Imam Hassan Al-Askari alayhi salatu wasalam, there is a man from the family of Ahmed alayhi salam. He's the great grandson of our 7th Imam. And he is in financial difficulties. He says to his son that I've heard that Abu Muhammad, yani Imam Hassan Al-Askari alayhi salam, is a very generous person. We are in financial difficulties. Let us go towards him and find out if he can help us. On the way, they are thinking, both of father and son, I need this much money for this, this much for this, this much for this. If I can get this much, then I can go and start my own business and become successful. When they arrive at the house, on the way, the father and son are having a conversation. Son says to the father, do you know Imam Muhammad? Have you ever met him before? Father says, I've never met him in my life. I don't know him. When father and son arrive at the house of Imam, the servant comes out and addresses both of them by name and says, oh so and so, son of so and so, Imam alayhi salam has invited you inside. The son is very surprised. My father had said on the way that he doesn't know the Imam. Yet we've arrived here and the Imam knows our name. When they go inside, whatever they had thought in their head about how much money they needed, the Imam presented that money towards them. The Imam gives them some advice, go towards such and such place, establish your trade there, and you will be successful. The narrator of this hadith, this is mentioned in Al-Irshad of Shaykh Mufid, the narrator of this hadith says that I went to visit this man, this great grandson of Imam Hussein, who had been helped by the Imam, and he was very successful in his life after that. He had set up his trade, he had followed the advice of the Imam, and he was successful. He said, I went to see him after that and I asked him, or I said to him, how strange is it that even after Imam Abu Muhammad al-Askari helped you, that you still believe a different belief? You don't believe him as the Imam, you rejected him as the Imam, you believe you are of the Waqifiyya belief, that belief that the Imam has stopped at Imam Hussein bin Ja'far alayhi salam. What more proof do you need that he is the Imam, that he addressed you by name even though you had never met him? He gave you that which you needed even though you didn't tell him. And whatever he told you to do was the reason for your success. Even after all of that, you still didn't accept him as the Imam? So this person says, yes, all of these things were there.
but I cannot leave the beliefs of my forefathers. I cannot leave the beliefs that our forefathers have handed down to us. Again, in this example, we saw that the Imam didn't ask him, what are your beliefs? And are you going to change your beliefs if I do this for you? Usually we operate on give and take. If you give me this, then I'll give you that. If I'm helping you today, I expect you to help me tomorrow. Imam Salamullah says, no. If you want to help people and you want to reach that state of generosity that Ahlul Bayt had, then you have to help people without expectations. Then you help people on the basis of, can I help this person? Do I have the ability to help this person? If the answer is yes, then I help that person without any expectations of whether that person will change their beliefs for me, whether that person will become guided or misguided. That is all in the hands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. For today, that is, inshallah, enough. The rest of what I want to refer to, inshallah, regarding the Holy Quran, we'll speak about tomorrow from the words of Amirul Mu'minin al-Salam regarding the importance of the Holy Quran. Then, inshallah, the day after, hopefully, we'll try and look at some of the signs of reappearance of our awaited Savior, inshallah, and hopefully that will take us towards the announcement of Eid, whenever that will be. And inshallah, we pray again in these final few days of the holy month of Ramadan, to, as we pray in that dua that we recited in the last 10 nights, that, oh Allah, if you have been pleased with us up until this point, then increase your pleasure. And if you have not become pleased with me up until this point, then from this moment onwards be pleased with me. I do not want to exit the holy month of Ramadan without you having become pleased with me and my actions. So we pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to receive his pleasure, inshallah. We pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to accept our actions and to make sure that this is not the last month of Ramadan of our lives. And we pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to protect the followers of Ahlul Bayt wherever they are in the world. We pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to hasten the reappearance of our awaited Savior and to make us amongst those who serve in Islamic. Rabbana taqabbal minna innaka anta as-sami'ul 'alim bihaqqi Muhammad wa alihi at-tahirin.
Allah.